Singapore's hottest hits.
So you guys are from Manchester. Is that the scene in Manchester right now?
No, this we kind of have been defined by living outside of the scene. Mm. We both didn't grow up in Manchester till we were like 12, 13, so our musical history wasn't really informed by, you know, Joy Division, Smiths, Oasis, Stone Roses, etc. We're not really inspired by those bands. As much as we give respect to them and the lineage that they have, it's never really inspired us musically. And because we didn't wear the whole badge of honour, like we're from Manchester, A lot of kids in Manchester really related to that because they were waiting for a band that wasn't so, didn't have such a tribalist outlook on music and where they were from and where music came from in that regard.
Now the band, the name 1975s, can you explain more about that? Because when we think about the 1975s, the first thing we think about is maybe it's one of the person's age.
Yeah, maybe. No, it's got nothing to do with that. The 1975 comes from just a book that I got given when I was like 19. And someone had used it as a diary before me. Mm-hmm. And they dated it just a lot, 1st of June, the 1975, 1st of June, the 1975. Obviously, somebody who speaks English, you'll know that that's kind of grammatically incorrect.
Yes.
It's something that just stuck with me, really. It wasn't that relevant until we came to naming the band, and it seemed just like the perfect name. So the year 1975 is actually totally irrelevant. It's the use of the word the and not understanding why it was there. That's where the name came from.
Cool. Well, let's start off with the first track of the album. It's labeled the 1975.
Yes.
It's got kind of like a Daft Punk kind of
ethereal vocals.
Feel to it. Why did you start off the album like that?
Well, it was a piece of music that George had started working on this piece of music, and when we both heard it, we listened to it and we thought, yeah, it's quite good, but there's one sound in it that was amazing. Mm-hmm. We liked the piece of music, but there was one sound that we loved. So we decided, when we both listened to it, we're like, that is the sound of the beginning of the album. That's what the beginning of the album needs to sound like. So we just took that sound and then took the vocal layering thing that we do throughout the whole album, you know, the 10 of my vocal making one.
Yes.
We use that across the whole of the album to realise the reason that it's so prominent at the beginning is because there's nothing else there.
Yes.
It's just that sound, a bass, and the vocal. And we just wanted, with like the title, the album's the 1975, the band's the 1975, and the record, the first song's the 1975, it was all about imposing our identity, making sure that we had a really, really coherent view of who we were and what we were doing.
Yep.
So we pretty much took all of the drama, all of the themes, and put them into this really, really minimalist piece of music at the beginning, and it was there.
Nice. Chocolate. Most likely the track that most people know you from right now.
Chocolate.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, you see, people say different things in different places.
Hmm.
Like in Australia, they go, oh, so the song everyone knows you for is Sex. Or they say, and now in the UK, it's starting to be Girls. Seems over here, yeah, it is Chocolate. Yeah, Chocolate seems to be our standout song.
It's such a sexy name, right?
Yeah, I know,
right? It's like you just want to eat it.
Exactly, it's perfect, it works. I think it's a really easy song, and it's pop music, you know, I think what's easier to kind of listen to, if you want to look into that song, then you can take a lot away from it.
Yeah.
But at face value, it's a pop song called Chocolate. No one's going to dislike that.
Yeah, well, it mentions, you know, references about drugs and so forth, but people think it's, they sing along to it. Like,
they don't have to.
Yeah.
It's whatever you want it to be. It doesn't have to be.
Yeah, I think it's one of those very
subjective narratives.
Exactly. Band influences. You mentioned a few of them earlier, but a huge influence to you is Michael Jackson, apparently. Is this something that you were brought up listening to him?
Yeah, like I was one of those kids who I went to see him live in like 1996 at Wembley and I cried at the whole time. I was like one of those kids.
Yep.
Like obsessed with Michael Jackson. I made a pantheon of Michael Jackson. He was the only person that I saw as like above anybody else. And I will never forget that moment. That moment where the curtain came down and I was at Wembley and he was there. I was like, that's Michael Jackson. Mm. That was the closest I'd ever been to having like any form of kind of view of like religion or anything like that. I know that sounds ridiculous to say. I wouldn't say that Michael Jackson is a genuine figure like that. Yeah, he's certainly not the Messiah. But I saw him like that. And because that's what kids, people didn't know what they wanted from Michael Jackson. He wasn't a figure of sexual desire or intellectual desire. People just wanted to consume him. He was like an energy. And the whole thing around Michael Jackson, so when I was a kid, seeing him live really catalyzed an urge within me to be like that. Mm. But as I grew older, I started to understand him and his music from a musical perspective.
Yeah.
And all of the formulas that he has within pop music, and then that really, really informed me as a songwriter.
Yeah, so much so that I think one of the songs, I hear a bit of sampling going on, sounding very much like Michael Jackson.
Yeah, it's probably quite a lot of it.
Yeah. Whereas like that, you've got a very, very unique vocal sound to yourself, almost yodeling.
Mm.
So did that just naturally come along? Did you get trained to do that kind of?
No.
Is this a natural kind of?
I don't really know. I never used to see myself as a singer.
Mm.
I just never used to know really what I was. I was a drummer until I was like 13. I didn't even sing. And then I started singing in this band, and just I couldn't really be like any other singer.
Just used to lose your voice horrendously.
Yeah,
all
I used
the time.
We used to be so heavy. When we first started singing, like.
Oh, screaming.
Like really hardcore screaming.
Yeah.
And then I realised that I had quite like a high voice when I sang, and I just started singing for the band. Started just having to make up my own style, I suppose.
Yeah.
I don't really think about it, it's just me singing.
Let's quickly touch on locally. Have you ever been to Singapore before?
No.
Ever been to Singapore?
Yes, I have. I got kidnapped in Singapore for a day.
Really?
Yeah. My dad was working in Australia, and my mum was on the way to Australia, and she had to stop off in 3 days for Singapore.
Yeah.
And there was her friend was staying there, and she said, well, let's get out of the city, come and stay where I live, which is about 2 hours outside in a kind of town, small town. Mm. I don't know where it was. She took me there, and she was shopping with me, and she must have turned around for a second, and the woman who owned the shop just became besotted with this little white baby that was just wandering around, not knowing what was going on. She picked me up and said, oh, I've got to take you to my friends. So all of these shops were owned by the same people, but my mum didn't know that. Mm. So she's taken me down to every single shop, showing me my friends. I was gone for about an hour. My mum had got the police down, like all this kind of thing. I was just walking around, like I was getting dressed up in all these kind of clothes and stuff.
Wow.
So yeah, but I can't remember it. But I was definitely being there. So I got nicked for like an hour. I'm looking forward to going back. Hopefully the same thing won't happen.
I hope so.
Hot FM 91.3, Singapore's hottest hits.